Good morning. Everybody's talking. It's very nice to see that. A warm welcome to all of you who are here today and those who may be viewing the service later on. It's a beautiful day again. Whether rain or cool, warm or sunshine, each day is a blessing. I read something a while ago by Rebecca Barlow Jordan in Mornings with Jesus, and it really made me think again. I think of it often when I become upset over something. In Philippians 4:11, it says, "I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances." I would like to say that that's me, but it sure isn't. And I would guess that you would say the same as me. Being content, whatever the circumstances. Just a little insert here. This morning, I was reading in Jesus Calling, and the reading was about learning the art of giving thanks in all circumstances. And it just was ironic to me that this is what I was going to talk about this morning, and it was in the reading this morning. How many times have you heard someone say such things as, "If only I was taller," which I've said, "I wish I was shorter," "I wish I had a bigger house," "I need a smaller place," "The weather is too hot," "I hate cold weather," "I don't like change," "It's so boring around here." Have you heard similar comments or complaints? God made us who we are. Why do we want to be different? Why can't we be thankful that we have a home and that we're not homeless? The weather is a big one. Everyone wants something different. Why can't we just be thankful that God has given us a new day? Unfortunately, complaining is a universal language. But it wasn't for the Apostle Paul. He had the ability to be content, whatever the circumstances. How did he come to this conclusion? In Philippians 4:12, it says, "I know how to live when I am poor, and I know how to live when I have plenty. I have learned the secret of being happy at any time and everything that happens." Paul went from being a formally educated Jew and persecutor of Christians to a helpless, blind disciple. A dramatic encounter with Jesus on the road to Damascus eventually turned him into a traveling missionary who experienced imprisonment, danger, and many near-death experiences. But he also made friends in every city who helped support his ministry. He definitely knew about extreme circumstances, both good and bad. Yet, Paul remained content. He said that the secret of victory that enabled him to be content in every situation was Jesus. Learning often involves a teacher, but Jesus was more than that. He's our friend, our encourager, our savior, and our strength. Jesus is the best reason to turn our complaints into some celebration. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for the many blessings you give us each day, for the beauty and wonder of your world. Help us to look to you as we go through each day in all situations, knowing that you are there with us. We are never alone. Thank you for the opportunity to come here together to worship you today. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, we have singing now with Cindy.
Good morning, folks. Thanks for this patience. We have a little issue going on. We're going to do the second song first that I had, but the first song that, or the second song we're going to sing is totally new to me, and Shirley Mary is going to help us with all of them. So the first one we're going to do is what they had up there, I guess. You want to do 507 first? That's fine. Okay, you want to go back to your plan? Okay, thank you.
Jesus said,
thank you, Cindy and Shirley and Geneva. Okay, are there any announcements? No? Okay, we come to a time of prayer and or praise.
Jim Devers. I'd like to wish Chick Nosher a happy birthday today. And he's retiring. No, I'm only kidding. But one of the things I like to say, by working in the sound system with him over the past few years, I've gotten to know him. And I feel very blessed in the church should also having Chick as a friend. And happy birthday, and many more years and a lot more work. I know he's never retiring like me.
Chick many, many, many years ago at the Swiss Road School, so I've known him all my life, and I don't think he's changed since then.
Yes, we do want to say thank you many times for Chick and all that he does up there, with
yes.
Carla and Jim and the rest of the sound crew. Just a quick couple of announcements. First of all, again, 2 weeks from today, there will not be a service here in the church building, but we will be at Beaver Camp, and it will be a 10:30 start. And we will celebrate with Madeline Plank with baptism and also have a potluck afterwards, so please come and worship there. Also, prayer requests this morning. It's been going out in the email for Elias and Jessica Zare. Elias is home now, and I just got an update from Jessica about a half an hour ago, and he is dealing somewhat with some anxious feelings being left alone. And a referral is being put in for a retransplant for lungs. He's been really struggling with his lungs the last several months. So continue to pray for Elias and Jessica.
I just want to thank everyone for the prayers for my dad, Todd Landecker. He's home now, and he's doing a lot better, but he's still stubborn as crap.
Hi, I just wanted to tell you that tonight's a special day for my dad. He continues to advance, building strength. Finally got in a car the first time, but, not driving. And tonight, he's requested to be anointed, and Evan Zare is going to do that at the house. Debbie continues to just really advance. It's wonderful to see a brand new Christian so excited. And actually, she's been there for a while, but this is actually the way that she's growing, like in the Word. And I praise God for your prayers. No matter what the outcome of their lives in the future, it's wonderful to see what God does when people are clinging close to Him.
I ran into Kay Weller this week, and I don't know if you know Kay and Rick Weller, but Kay, who's never smoked in her life, is dealing with fourth stage lung cancer. So if you would keep Kay in your prayers. I also ran into Darkie this week, and if you went to Lowell, you know who Darkie is. There were two twins, Darkie and Blondie. Her sister is not doing well at all, her twin sister, and I said that I would ask everyone I know to pray for these two girls that's really some major health problems. I also would ask that you would remember my granddaughter Morgan in your prayers. She's stranded with a 4-year-old and a 1-year-old in Syracuse. Her flight was canceled, and she's in Georgia living near her dad. So if you would remember Morgan in Syracuse with these two children, not sure when she's going to get out, I would appreciate it. Thank you. And Bob is doing very, very well. in 2 weeks, he has to see the doctor again. So we've gone from 3 visits a week to 1 in 2 weeks. Hallelujah.
Okay, we go to prayer, please. Father, we look to you this morning and ask that you be with each of the requests offered here. We pray for Elias and Jess and the boys and the family as they go through this most difficult time of making decisions and knowing what to do. May you be near to them and help them as they make these decisions. Help them to feel your presence and know that you are with them through this journey. We thank you that Todd Leindecker is home, that he's doing better. Just pray that you be with him and help him to continue in healing. Be with Cindy's father as he continues to heal also and go on with his life as best he can. Be with the family as they are there with him also. And please be with Shirley's friends with their health issues. We just pray for healing. We pray that you be near to them, help them to feel your presence, to know that they are not alone. And with Morgan in Syracuse, we just pray again that the doctors would be able to care for her and do what is needed. We also ask that you would be with any unspoken needs. You know who they are and what the concern is. Thank you for loving and caring for us each day. In Jesus' name, amen. We have a scripture reading with Ada Baker.
God has raised this Jesus to life, and we were all witnesses of it. Exalted to the right hand of God, he has received from you the Father that promised Holy Spirit and has poured out what you now see and hear. For David did not ascend to heaven, and yet he said, "The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet." Therefore, let all of Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom we crucified, both Lord and Messiah.
Thank you, Ada. Will ushers please come forward for the morning offering? Let's pray. Lord, you have blessed us so much. Thank you for the opportunity to give back a portion of what you've given us. May we bless others with this offering. Bless the gift and the giver. In your holy name, amen. The special music, Meredith, will not be here today, so we'll welcome Ed.
Thank you, Karen, and good morning and welcome to each of you. I will have to say I probably threw the monkey wrench into the singing this morning because I gave them that one song, that extra one, so probably on me. Sorry about that. But I do welcome each of you. And last week, I had mentioned the fact that a lot of you were probably preparing for the county fair and doing those things. And I hope if you visited the fair this week that you enjoyed your experience. You probably had the chance to enjoy a flash flood on one of the days and 100 degree temp on another day. I actually had the opportunity on Tuesday morning to bring the invocation at the opening ceremony, which was pretty cool. And I had never been there for that and didn't know what to expect. And there were quite a few people there. But as I was standing there and saw the ribbon being cut and the people cheering and standing there ready and anxious for everything that was coming in the days ahead, I had to think about the thousands of people that were going to enter through the gates into the fair this past week. And I say thousands because I know literally there were thousands of people. And as I was thinking about that, I was thinking about how every single person that was coming into the fair this week had their own story. Every person individually has their own story. And have you ever considered that each of you that are here right now, and that might be listening to this later online, each of you are creating your own story. Every single day we're creating our own story, whatever that may be. And it's kind of exciting to think about that we all have our own stories. You know, throughout the years, through our ups and downs and twists and turns and roadblocks and celebrations and everything that's involved in our life, all of those things get recorded in our story. Now, I don't know if you write your stories down. I know some of you journal, and my kids are going to have years and years worth of journals to throw away when something happens to me. I started journaling back when Cheryl and I first got married, so there's 40 years worth of journals in a couple of drawers. And the only good thing about them, really, is sometimes we'll go back and say, oh, that's when it happened, or sometimes I use it to show that I knew what happened. Right, Cheryl? Because I got it documented. But anyways, the older that we get, the more stories that we have. The longer we live, the more we experience. And the thing that I notice is the older people get, the farther back they go to tell their stories. And I'm not sure why that is. That oftentimes people reach back 40, 50, 60 years to tell a story from long ago. And you know this, when somebody starts out by saying, well, long story short, it's not going to be short. And I've also found that people that use that phrase tell a lot of stories. And so if you hear long story short, you know there's probably a short time, a short story that's going to be long. So hold on. But the Bible itself is really about stories. It's stories of thousands of people throughout thousands of years that we're connecting to God and Jesus and the Holy Spirit. And so this morning I'd like to give some attention to that. And so if you saw in the title of the message in the bulletin, it's three stories in nearly 3,000 years. So I'm going to tell a couple of those stories this morning from the Bible. And I'm going to begin by relating first about a story that took place some 600 plus years prior to Jesus ever being here. And it involved four Israelite men, and you may know them by the name of Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. And you might better know them as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego from the story of the burning fire and all that kind of stuff. But these were smart, really good-looking guys. They were educated. They brought attention when they walked into a room. And people pointed them out because they seemed to know quite a bit. And Daniel, he was one of those four guys. Daniel had an understanding of a lot of different things. He understood dreams and interpreted experiences in ways that other people couldn't. In Daniel chapter 5, verse 12, it says that he had a keen mind, that he had an ability to understand dreams and explain riddles and solve difficult problems. Now, I know I could never understand riddles. I still don't get them. If you ever run into Romy, before a service, he'll tell you a joke. I can never remember a riddle or a joke. I might tell you the punchline or forget the rest of it. But Daniel had this way of telling things and understanding things and interpreting things that not everybody had an ability to do. And Daniel, because of that, he was called upon by the royal kingship of the time, the royalty, to do some pretty amazing things. And he was put in charge, and he was given leadership and authority over a lot of peoples because of his abilities. It's part of his story. Now, as is so often the case, when somebody gets a lot of notoriety and they have abilities that others don't have, those that don't have those abilities and can't do such things get a little bit jealous. And that's what happened to Daniel. These other people, these other leaders that are around that had been assigned by the kings, they started getting jealous of Daniel because they couldn't do everything that Daniel could do. And so they made up this conspiracy theory about Daniel and tried to catch him in something. And they asked the king to order something that only the king could do. And they said, could you place into an order that people can only bow down and pray to you? And the king hesitantly did that. The king hesitantly did it, but he did. He put a decree out that for the next 30 days, people could only pray to him. Could only pray to him. So let's go to Daniel chapter 6 and see what happens here. So these guys that had convinced the king to do this, and I'm sure they're sitting back and laughing and saying, okay, we're going to get Daniel now. We're going to catch him. We're going to trip him up. He's getting too popular. So in Daniel chapter 6 says this. Now when Daniel learned that the decree, the order had been published, he went home to his upstairs room with the windows open towards Jerusalem, and three times a day he got down on his knees and prayed. Right out for everybody to see. Knowing that those guys that had just convinced the king were going to be walking by and looking for him, he went ahead and prayed. And he continued to do that throughout those 30 days. Well, those guys did see that he was doing that. And so what did they do? They went running back to the king to tattle on David. Say, you put into an order that people could only pray to you. This man named David, who you put in charge of a lot of people, he's doing more. He's praying to his God. And you put into order that there had to be punishment. So we know what happens. Daniel got thrown into the lion's den. The lion's den was sealed by the king. Nobody could open it up. The next day, going back to that lion's den, what did they find? They found that David was alive. David answered the king and saying this, oh, king, live forever. My God sent his angel, and he shut the mouths of the lions. They have not hurt me because I was found innocent in his sight, nor have I ever done anything wrong before you, O king. So David used that experience to teach the king himself a lesson. And all those other guys that had any doubt about David, I'm sure they went sheepishly home that night saying, oh, we have nothing over this guy. He has the power from his God to even shut the mouths of the lions. So that's a story. That's a story of a dedicated man thousands of years ago who loved God so much that he put his life in jeopardy to even be thrown into a lion's den. So let's jump ahead about 600 years. And it was about 2,000 years ago from now. And there's a man named Peter. A man named Peter. And we've learned about Peter throughout the many years and reading in the Bible and the New Testament, the actions of Peter. Peter was a fisherman. So likely, he probably smelled like a fisherman coming off his boat. His hands would have been rough from the ropes and everything that he had to use and putting out the nets to fish with. My guess is that Peter also had a bit of a salty tongue, because he was around guys that likely didn't believe in God. And so he was all of that. Peter was all of that. And then we hear about him. If we go to Matthew chapter 4. This man named Jesus, who had just kind of come on the scene. He was just starting his ministry. He's walking along the Sea of Galilee. He saw two brothers, Simon called Peter and his brother Andrew, and they were casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. Come follow me, Jesus said, and I will make you fishers of men. At once, they left their nets and followed him. So upon hearing that, what did Peter do? Dropped his nets, left his boat, I'm sure he tied it up, didn't want to lose his boat, and off he went, following Jesus. He played a key role. This man named Peter played a key role in the whole ministry of Jesus. If we go ahead to Matthew chapter 14. Matthew 14, and this is where Jesus was walking out on top of the water. We know that story. Another one of those beautiful stories of the Bible. He just decided to walk out and greet his disciples out in the boat. And for a second time, he tells Peter, come, come to me. So Jesus is away out from the boat, and Peter's on the boat, and he tells Peter, hey, come out. Or Jesus says, come, Peter, come to me. So what does Peter do? He jumps into the water. He jumps into the water and goes towards Jesus, walking on the water. Now, if I'm one of the other friends of Peter, my thought, as I believe their thoughts probably was, well, that's par for the course. There goes Peter doing another Peter thing. Jumping out in the water, what does he think he is? You know, does he think he's God? But then they see him. Can you imagine their eyes when they see Peter starting to walk on the water out towards Jesus? But then what happens? Peter starts sinking. He starts realizing what it is, and fear takes over. He starts thinking about, I can't do this, and I'm going to sink. But what does Jesus do? Plucks him out of the water. I had to think about that a little bit, and thinking, how couldn't we all possibly be Peters? That we want to serve Jesus so badly in our lives, and we see him out there, yes, we're going to follow him, we're going to do everything that Jesus wants us to do, and then fear and reality of what the situation is takes over, and we start to sink, just like Peter. But what does Jesus do in our lives, in our story? Time and time again, reaches down, picks us back up, puts us back in the boat. That's our story, just like Peter. And then in John chapter 18, there's another story of Peter with Jesus. Jesus was being arrested. Now, Peter was all puffed up in this situation, and like, how dare you touch my friend Jesus? And so he draws his sword, and he strikes off the ear of this servant of a high priest. Now, it could have ended there, or it could have got worse from there, but Jesus responds to Peter and says, oh, Peter, come on, put your sword away. That's not needed right here. A beautiful, little, small little story that's tucked into this big story. Jesus says to Peter, Peter, why are you always so impulsive? Put that sword away. This needs to happen. And he comforts him. You know, again, I was thinking about it. Don't we all want to be a hero sometimes? Don't we all want to be that go-to person that somebody else might want to count on? I think that's what Peter was feeling. I'm going to be the hero here. I'm going to chop the guy's ear off and save the day for Jesus. Not thinking, well, Jesus doesn't need any help. Part of the beautiful story. The other thing is, it's a reminder, Peter was a real person. Peter was a real person who was passionate. He was passionate about Jesus. So passionate that he would walk on water to try to get to Jesus. So passionate that he would take out a sword to try to defend Jesus. And then if we go to Acts chapter 2, thank you, Ada, for doing that. This morning she was a little nervous. You did a great job. You could do it again. Acts chapter 2. Peter's taken on a new role. Jesus was no longer present. He had gone up into heaven. And Peter and all the disciples were left. Part of the story. They had work to do. They were to continue the work that Jesus had started. And it says this in Acts chapter 2. Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed the crowd. Fellow Jews and all who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. So Peter, the same man that did all those other crazy things, Peter was also one of the two disciples that ran to the tomb, saw the empty tomb, and he got there after John. Probably was upset that John beat him. But he's that same man that stood in front of hundreds of people and said, listen to what I have to tell you. Peter and all his craziness became this masterful leader, this passionate speaker for Jesus. He matured into something different. than just that impulsive, immature fisherman. He matured into a man that would tell people what Jesus did. If we go down to verse 31, it says, "Seeing what was ahead, he spoke of the resurrection of Christ, that he was not abandoned to the grave, nor did his body see decay." So he told the people, this Jesus, he didn't really die like all of us died. He was going around telling people, this Jesus who we witness come back to life is real and continues to be for us. So now let's come ahead at 2,000 years. That's us right now. 2022, 2,000 years after Jesus was here, we are now continuing on with that story. Each and every one of us has to be a part of this beautiful, dramatic saga. Now, as I look around, each of you have had your own dramatic events in your life, no doubt. We heard some of those prayer requests this morning, some of those praises. We've all played into writing a chapter into this book. And I think that we have these dramatic events in our life too, so we can contribute and tell others how God has worked throughout those. It's the saga of living a life for God. That's what it is. It's a story of living the life for God. At this time, I'm going to ask Sarah to come forward. Sarah Wood has had the chance, come on up. She had the chance to be a part of a program at Lemoyne this last year and then had a wonderful experience that took place this summer, part of the story. So Sarah, anxious to hear about it.
I'm going to try and make a long story short, and I will actually try and keep it short, I promise. So I got to thinking about my story. I heard Ed's title of the message, and I thought it would be a great opportunity to share a little bit of my testimony. So most of you know that my family started coming here some 5-6 years ago. I started going to church when I was young, and I stopped going when I was about 12 years old because I started playing soccer competitively. That was a very frustrating time for me because I had always known that I wanted to be in church. I knew that there was something different about God and I wanted to be there. But looking back, I wish I could tell my 12-year-old self it would be okay, that he would bring me back to church one day. So fast forward, I'm going to college and I hear of this group called BASIC, stands for the Brothers and Sisters in Christ. And for whatever reason, I felt like God was calling me to this group. He knew that I needed to be there, be surrounded by people who are also believers in a place where a lot of bad things happen and where people go wrong. So I knew I need to be at this group, and I had the opportunity to go to a conference, and at this conference, I heard about a mission trip. And the second that I heard about it, I knew that God wanted me there. I knew he had something there for me. So this May, I went to California with a group of 3 other girls. I'm not gonna lie, I had no idea what to expect. I was terrified. I feel like it was God's way of saying, put yourself out there in this world, go see what I have to offer. And the second that I got there, I felt like home. I mean, it felt like home. I went to this place called the Dream Center, and it's a huge building. It used to be a hospital, actually, but they renovated it to be a building for people who are recovering addicts, people who need to get out of the world, homeless people, and just get into a place where they can be around people who know God and who can change their lives. And I am so grateful for the opportunity that I got to go because God changed my life so much during that time. So I wrote down some notes because I knew I wouldn't be able to remember everything that happened, but... So one of the days I got to go to a young adults group, and it was an entire church full of people my age who were so on fire for God, and it was... I really wish I could explain the feeling, but it's like no other. Being in a room full of people like this, where people just want to worship the Lord and be in community with him and enjoy his presence. So that was, I knew that from that, I wanted to come back here and start a young adults group. And I kid you not, I was praying about it. I was like, God, I don't know if I can do this by myself. I don't know how to run a young adults group. But like a week later, I heard that another church in our community was actually starting a young adults group. And I was like, praise the Lord. He did that. He knew I couldn't do it, but he knew someone else could. So then another day while I was there, we went to Skid Row, and that is one of the blocks in Los Angeles where there's a lot of homeless people. And sorry, I get emotional thinking about it because it was such an experience. I learned so much about how we all need to be so desperate for God, because there are these people there who we were literally providing them their only meal of the day, and it was a bag of chips and a little thing of orange juice. And yet they were the ones teaching me about how to be desperate for God. Each one of them had their own faith, and they believed more that God would provide for them than I have ever believed in my life. So yeah, I learned so much about how to be desperate for God. And then we also did a children's program. It was kind of like VBS, but they do it every week, and they have kids come and sit around. They teach them a Bible story, and then we just play. We get to have fun with these kids who live in a not so nice area with families who can't necessarily provide for them, but we're there and we're sharing the joy of the Lord with them. And so that was a great opportunity as well. And then two of the days we got to do foster care intervention. So there are these people who need help in their lives, but they have no one to provide it for them. And so the Dream Center sends them furniture, and they provide other things for them as well. But for the most part, it's an opportunity to keep families together, because without furniture in a home, without enough beds for the kids, these parents would be losing their children to the foster care system. So the Dream Center provides furniture for these people to be able to stay with their family. And hearing those people say thank you, like, I was just one small person doing one small thing, but to them it meant the world, because they could stay with their family and they could have their kids with them every single day. And then probably my favorite part of the trip, we got to do sort of outreach. We got to provide food and groceries to the community. And let me tell you, I have no sense of speaking Spanish. All they spoke was Spanish. So I'm trying to learn Spanish as I'm giving food to them. And all the people working there are like trying to kind of teach us Spanish at the same time. And I was terrified, because I'm like, God, I don't know how to speak to these people. But more importantly, it made me think how he can use anybody in any situation, regardless of a language barrier, and you can feel the love of God with them. You can share the love of God with them. It doesn't matter whether you speak English or Spanish. He can work in every and any situation to make sure that he is made known, because he is God. He's like that. He can do that. So that was an amazing experience. Like I said, I'm gonna try and keep this short, but I do wanna end in scripture, something that's been speaking to me lately. It's Romans 8:28. It says, "And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them." This is something I've been learning each and every single day. Like I said, I wish I could tell my 12-year-old self that it would be okay, because I know that God has a story for me now. Even though I used to be ashamed that I didn't go to church when I was younger, I wasn't raised that way, I know that he has me here now for a reason, and that I'm so excited for whatever else he has in store for me. Thank you.
That was wonderful. Thank you, Sarah, for sharing. I did have to smile a little bit when she said, I wrote some notes down, and then she pulled out her phone. And this is 2022. I guess you write your notes differently than I did. But isn't that awesome? It's so awesome to hear her new story. And the thing is that God can give us confidence in new ways to carry our story forward. Sarah, you would agree, you couldn't have done this a few years ago, right? But God gave her confidence, and Anna shared that. They came to youth here a month or so ago and shared a little bit about going on this trip. And Anna said she was so proud of Sarah for seeing that confidence developing. And that's what God does. So as I share that, each and every one of you, in your own unique ways, with your own abilities, is creating your own God story. Each of us does that. No matter what the events may be in life, no matter the traumatic things we may experience, God is in that and helping us to create our story and how we respond to that. So my question is, what is your story today? What is your story today in 2022? It's definitely different than it will be in 10 years from now. And we continue to write chapters into our story. Well, this morning, to conclude my part of it, I'm going to have a video played. And for those of you that are watching this and will watch this online, either Facebook or YouTube, you will not see this video on the recording. You will need to go to YouTube and look up Katie Nicole and Big Daddy Weave. And the song is called God Is In This Story. Jim, if you'd play it, please. To be here this Sunday. And I didn't even see this song until Thursday. First time I'd ever seen it. It's a new song out. And I thought, that goes directly with the message today. So as I share that with you and share this song, God is in this story. But most importantly, God is in your story. He's in my story. And he's in each of our stories. At this time, I'll ask Cindy and Shirley and Janita to come back and lead us in the closing song.
I just wanted to say a quick word, and I don't often do that, but that was awesome, Sarah. And it really touched my heart because I have a few tears, but I have to tell you. Today is my son Bobby's birthday. And when we found him, Jeff found him on the internet, knew where he was, and when his father and I, Bobby's father and I, actually located Bobby in Tampa, Florida, and just outside the home, the Salvation Army, where he was lined up to get his meal, he had no idea that we found him. I just experienced the quietest, politest group of homeless that were waiting for him. And of course, when he recognized us, I thought he would run, so I put his father ahead of me. And when he turned around, he, you know how tall my son is, 6'3". He just lunged past his father and hugged me and said, it's time to go home now. And then he said, Mom, I want to say goodbye. And he went around to each person, and there were beautiful girls there. They were beautiful, and they were the age of 17, 18, 19. There was a man in a wheelchair. And he just went around, and there were several other men. He just said, I'm going home now. I'll keep thinking about you. I have never forgot those faces. And of course, my son got the medical help, and he's now independently living in Saratoga Springs. This church was praying for us and him. And I haven't come back since we came home to tell you how thankful I am. But I want to tell you that that message was so important because God's Spirit is always there. And I pray that those people that we've been praying for all these years, they somehow found their way home too. So thank you.
Thank you.
thank you, Cindy, for sharing that. Just a couple of announcements. Next Sunday, Connie Zehr, who's our New York Mennonite Conference moderator, is going to be bringing the message. And so welcome her with wide open arms. Cheryl and I are going to be on vacation. We're leaving Tuesday afternoon, and we'll return the next Thursday. If you have any needs, any specific needs, contact one of the oversight team members, and they will help to assist in whatever ways may be needed. And which reminds me, oversight team, if we can meet up here shortly after the service just to speak for a few minutes. And again, in 2 weeks, 2 weeks from today, we'll be at Beaver Camp for another celebration, and looking forward to the baptism time as well. Let's pray. God, we're just reminded again today, we are part of your story. Each and every single one of us, in our own unique and individual ways, have a piece of that story. God, I thank you again for Sarah and her willingness to share this morning and how she's been able to expand her part of the story and her family. God, I ask you to help us recognize that every day we're writing a new piece of that story for you. Help us to touch others with your love. Amen.